Hey friends, you may know that you can use Azure Functions to run code on demand without having to manage infrastructure, but did you know that Azure Functions enables you to build highly scalable serverless APIs? Jeff Hollan is here to show me how today on Azure Friday. Hey friends, I'm Scott Hanselman and it's Azure Friday. I'm here with Jeff Hollan. How are you, sir?
I'm doing great today.
So, serverless. Promise of no servers. I am finding a little bit of confusion in the space. I recently had a site kind of go down. Azure Functions was involved and I started to point fingers and then I realized as I was pointing my fingers that there were three more fingers pointing back at me. And maybe I didn't understand or my team wasn't understanding how serverless works. What does that really mean? When do I know that there are services and or is it virtual machines and real compute and when is it handled for me? And you know, how did that happen?
Sure. Yeah. And this, we were chatting a little bit before filming and learned a little bit about the incident that happened. And the good news is we're going to talk about exactly that today.
Awesome.
And to start with serverless, yeah, the word is problematic to say the least. But to your point, it's just about thinking about those servers less. But there are different degrees in where that might be a factor and where it might apply. What we see is there's a ton of interest in the idea of like, hey, I don't want to have to manage servers. I have variable workloads. And really where I think Azure Functions starts to come in is I want to optimize as much as I can towards getting this functional productivity done quickly. We see a ton of interest from users who start with functions, specifically around like APIs. There's a lot of functions you can write. You can write functions that trigger on queues or on scheduled events, but like, hey, I have a mobile backend or I have a retail site and I have some processing needs to happen. I want to save some cycles from the website. I'm going to offload that to a function that's acting as an API. Super interesting. But there's a lot there that needs to happen behind the scenes for that to take effect. And I figured we could spend today and show a little bit about what is happening and how you can use that to make sure that you're making the most of your serverless APIs.
That is really helpful. And I just want to say that your that analogy, that little cute statement of like, it's not about no servers, it's about thinking about them less. That is hugely helpful because I think that people thought that we as a community, as a technology community, were just going, oh, pretend there's no computers anymore. It's not computerless, it's just less thought about servers. Because when I was running my blog, even as recently as a couple weeks ago, I was running it on a computer and then on a virtual machine and now on an app service. I am thinking less and less about the underlying machine. It's like, hey, there's a physical computer. Hey, there's a virtual machine. I have to remote update and go and like run Windows Update. Hey, there's a machine there and it probably runs Windows. I don't know, maybe it runs Linux. It doesn't really matter, but I know it's up to date. I could keep moving my way up the stack to less and less server in my head.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think along those lines, it's important for folks to know the fact that we're not saying don't think about things anymore. Don't think that you're not going to have to operate the service anymore. Don't think that, you know, you aren't ever going to have any hiccups. We will work as hard as we can to make sure if there is a hiccup, it's not coming from some of the layers that we're managing.
Yeah.
But you still need to make sure that you're being aware that, hey, I need to set alerts for this thing and I need to check it from time to time and I need to make sure that I am pulling in updates where they might make sense. No ops, which sometimes you'll see but get thrown around with serverless, I don't buy it. I don't think there is such thing as no ops, maybe just more focused ops on different elements. You still need that ops element.
Right, right. And by ops, you mean like there's no one paying attention, like it runs itself. It's a self-driving car, a self-driving website. That doesn't exist yet. Keep your hands on the wheel. You gonna share your screen and show me a demo?
Yeah, let's see it. So I'll show you very quickly here what an Azure function looks like. And then we're going to kind of go through a day in the life of an Azure function. And so here in Visual Studio Code, this is a serverless API using Azure Functions. And right off the bat, you can see some reasons that folks like it. This is not a whole lot of lines of code. This is only the only Python file in this case. This could be PowerShell. This could be .NET. This could be JavaScript or TypeScript. But I just come in here and I say, hey, there's an event that I care about. In this case, it's an HTTP event. And this is the line of Python code that I want you to run whenever that event triggers, whenever that fires. And so here I could write whatever business logic or data or whatever I need to pull in whatever libraries I want. But I'm very much just thinking, this is the code I care about. This is the function I need to execute in a fully managed way. You write that, and when you're ready to go, you can just publish it up into the cloud and have it listen to that event and run your code whenever that thing happens. And as I mentioned, that could be a number of different things that are telling us to run your bit of Python or .NET or whatever code.
Okay.
So what I wanted to show here is when you do publish. So if I go ahead now, it looks like my Visual Studio Code extension is not super happy. So let's reload the window. So what I want to show now is that when I do publish, if I go ahead here to my Visual Studio Code extension, and maybe I now want to run this to run in the cloud, I have a few different options here that I can select. And one that I want to call out here quickly, so let's just call this my Azure Friday function. I am using Python, so I'll select that right here. There's a few different hosting plans. So premium, this is, as the name would make you believe, a more premium version. This gives you things like virtual network connectivity. It makes it so things like cold start or latency go away. But there's a bit of a cost implication there. It scales the same way as you would think an Azure function would scale, but you're paying a little bit more for some of these value-added features. Where most people are going to want to hang out is right here in consumption. Consumption is the generic, often serverless way of running this thing. It means only pay when the code is actually running. We will go spin it up on a huge pool of compute behind the scenes, and it will run on demand at scale whenever you need. This app service plan, this is pretty advanced. This is only if you want to run your version alongside your website code. It doesn't make sense for a whole lot of people unless you want some of the premium stuff, but you just want it to run inside of a plan you're already paying for. In general, though, I would recommend folks publish in one of these first two plans. Specifically, the consumption plan is going to be the right option for most folks. It's the less expensive, which is a big reason it's that way.
Right. In the context for my particular issue was that I made two mistakes. One was I ran it in an app service plan, which is basically saying I want more control when in fact I wanted less. And I also happened to run it in the app service plan of the website. So the website was calling itself. So I would hit a page and I'd turn around and I'd go out and I'd come right back and hit myself three or four times. Hence the three fingers pointing back at me. I should have just gone for, sounds like a consumption or a premium.
Yes, yeah, for sure. And so what will happen now when I do that, and I can actually switch a window here to show the portal. This is a function I published in the consumption plan ahead of time. And there's some interesting things I want to call out. And we mentioned them a bit when I was selecting this hosting plan for this serverless API. So here I have my function. It's an HTTP function ready to trigger and listen to. I want to come here to this monitor tab, though, because we inject into every Azure function application insights. And with application insights, you can actually watch the servers behind the scenes of serverless. And this helps you understand what is happening with these serverless APIs and even where some of the value happening. So it's interesting, you might have even noticed while I was talking, this server count right here went to one server online. Before, I hadn't touched this function in a long time. I think because I was navigating around the portal, we use that as a signal that says I might be about to call this thing. But you can actually see behind the scenes in some Azure data center, here is server BCE779BC. I actually recognize the name of the server. This is one of our best, Scott, who has shown up for us today to run our function live. But you can see here that in this case, we got a signal that we assumed at this point that this was going to be called. We spun up a server behind the scenes. So there's that server we talked about still exists. Now, I'm not paying for this yet. You only pay in functions when your code is actually executing. But it is interesting to note you can observe what's happening here and how those resources are being sent. Now, I want to show one of the value props here is because I've chosen the consumption plan, I'm going to go ahead and run a scale test at this function. So I'm going to throw 800 concurrent clients for a minute at this simple little Azure function that just returns back hello world. It's not doing a whole lot. But if I switch back here quickly to the live view, but you'll see very quickly the telemetry here is starting to spin up. And we recognize, oh, there are a lot of requests that are coming in. This thing is being hit by a lot of stuff. There's a little bit of a latency here and as the servers scale up. But what we should notice, hopefully before I finish this sentence, is that we recognize, oh, there is more traffic here than that single, as great as that server was, that single server can handle. And so you can see here in real time, within just a few seconds, Azure Functions is adapting and it is scaling out. Now it's at 9, 10 servers online, 12 servers online with just a few seconds to make sure that, hey, we have enough infrastructure to handle what's creeping up to about 3,000 requests a second while keeping that latency pretty low. So this is where I just started with that function in VS Code. I didn't make any changes. I didn't configure any knobs. I just wrote that Python code. I published it to the cloud, and then I threw a massive amount of load at it. But the value prop here of the serverless function is by choosing Azure Functions, I didn't have to write a whole lot of code, but I get things like this auto-scale logic that will spin me up to these servers behind the scenes, but I'm not really thinking about them. Like they even have names that let you know, I don't really know about these things. They're here for when I need them and they go away when I'm done.
Okay, well, let me ask a clarifying question then. In this example though, your Python code isn't really doing anything. It is fairly naive. It's not calling a back end. If I have a website or a mobile app or whatever that calls Azure Functions and I can scale from one server that I'm not paying for to 17 that I am, and then back down again when the traffic goes away, that presumes that something else downstream can do that kind of stuff, that the underlying data source, whether it be Cosmos or a third party or an existing SQL server or an Azure storage blob, couldn't the downstream, the leaf node, the most dependent thing in your stack, be basically beaten up by a very powerful scalable Azure function?
Yeah, absolutely. Like as exciting as this is, if you just think about the function where it's like, great, I did 3,000 requests a second on this Azure function, when you're the SQL server admin who's managing the SQL server that this function might be calling, those numbers might be very concerning to you. So this is definitely something that comes up from time to time, thinking about what are the other elements of your application that are calling and how scalable or how much they might be able to handle. Sometimes it's just rate limiting in general, like, hey, I'm calling an email inbox and the email API can only handle so many calls. So a few things on that that I'll show quickly. If I pop back over here to the Azure portal where I can manage my function, we do have a new setting here under consumption plan calls where you can actually enforce a scale out limit. Now, this isn't necessarily perfect because it does require you to do some thinking, but I can choose, hey, in this case, as you saw from the live metrics, I went to 17 servers. Maybe I know if I go above about like 2 servers that things are going to start to tip over. I could actually tell Azure Functions, you know, it slowed down a little bit. I only can have you handle going to 2. I'll go ahead and save
it. And we'll make sure that. Or 10 or 15 or whatever.
Or 10, right. Yeah. So you have to do a little bit of reasoning. Like it's not as granular today as saying I only want to handle this many requests per second. Mm-hmm. But it is an option that becomes really helpful so that you can do some bounds, specifically when you're thinking about what downstream thing might this function be calling.
Right. And I think it's really interesting because I think we're starting to see Azure Functions become the glue by which we plug in lots of other things as a service. Little Cosmos here, a little Azure Search there, some blob storage there, each one with its individual scalable characteristics based on our usage patterns and different assumptions that we might make. And if function sits in the middle and can scale horizontally as much as it likes, then we have to really think about the scalability of each downstream data source or third-party API that we might call with functions, and then perhaps introduce some more sophisticated caching in the Azure Functions layer because it's the most scalable of the layers.
Yeah, absolutely. Yep, it is. In the glue is just the word too. I would just echo again, one of the values of doing these serverless APIs with functions is that they make a nice glue thing when you're gluing systems together. Nice. So there's one more element in the topic of serverless APIs that I want to show quickly here. This is a feature that will be familiar to most folks who've used something like app services before, but this is a nice value add that you get when you use Azure to host your serverless APIs, and that's that you still have the ability to use things like deployment slots. So if we think about that simple function that I have, well, what happens when I need to make a change? I need to version it to do something else. I have a simple function that I run that controls some lights around my house. And if I want to make a change to it, I don't want to inadvertently have downtime, or maybe I am processing thousands of requests a second. When I make that change, I don't want all of those to fail. So I can configure what are deployment slots that, again, these are identical to like an app service web app slot, where I could deploy some code to this slot. I could say, you know what, I need to swap this now. The dev code has the code I need. Let's swap it into production. Mm-hmm. And we'll gracefully handle that traffic as you test and validate it in those development slots.
Very cool. Interesting. Again, an opportunity to think about a best practice in technology and maybe not even think about a server. Maybe there's a dev server, maybe there's not. It's a slot. It's a logical slot, not a physical server. Or is it?
Absolutely. Yeah, exactly this. So those are just a few elements. There's more there, and there's plenty we could talk about in this regard. But I think we've just seen a lot of uptake and usage around these scenarios of, hey, I've got my event, in this case, an API, like I mentioned, maybe this is a mobile backend. More recently, we're seeing a lot of interest around Blazor backends. Like maybe I'm going to use this totally modern static website pattern of having a web page that's rendered in the browser. When it needs to call some APIs behind the scenes, those could be Azure Functions written in any language. So there's a lot of capabilities here, both in terms of scale, both in terms of deployment slots that will help you in managing and maintaining those serverless options. But definitely something that everybody should consider is they're thinking about how to host those serverless APIs or APIs in general.
Very cool. Sounds like for really scalable serverless APIs that Azure Functions is the ticket. And we're going to include in the show notes links to ways that they can accelerate your enterprise. We're going to have all the documentation and how to do serverless web applications on Azure. Thanks so much, Jeff Hollan.
Thank you.
I'm learning all about Azure Functions today on Azure Friday. Hey, thanks for watching this episode of Azure Friday. Now I need you to like it, comment on it, tell your friends, retweet it, watch more Azure Friday.